I have been entrusted to make you somewhat cultured. I do think that the word is rather more misused than used. No, the important thing is that I'll rather interact with you on the cultural developments and the cultural achievements of India. Now, before I start the actual topics or the actual important events, I want to mention just it is my impression about five important features of Indian cultural achievement or Indian cultural history. The first is that in India we don't have any tradition of history writing. No history writing, no history. It's part of Indian culture that we did not have any historians. And probably the first book on history in India by an Indian was that by Kalhan. So that was Raj Tarangini, a Kashmir scholar, Kalhan wrote. That was more a kind of a literary exposition than a history book. So what we do and what the scholars have done, this is a question very often you write that this is a question that should we use the traveler's accounts, the foreign scholars, the other scholars who commented on Indian history, on Indian society. As far as the travelers are concerned, their number is large. Many people came. Fa Hian came, a Chinese. Megasthenes was the ambassador of Seleucus in the court of Chandragupta. And you know that Megasthenes wrote that book, Indica. That was, and from that we have taken this name, India. And so there were still others and who continued to come. One of the persons, T. Sam, Chinese, more than him, Huanzang. His accounts are, Huanzang was a great person, very energetic, and he wrote a record in Chinese language which is more than 2000 pages. Lived probably 13 to 14 years in India. He had come in 1630, and 630 he went in 644 or 643. He moved all over India. He went to Kashmir, he went to Punjab, he went to this Kamrup or present day Assam, then also went to South India, even to Tanjore. And the records he has prepared of that period, those are really important, very extensive. And others also, so that other scholars, and some of them, they are not travelers. Rajak came, Masudi, probably you know about him. He is called the Herodotus of the Arabs. He also came to India. And I'll just tell you, I'll dictate in brief, but he'll be fast, somewhat faster. So these are the people who came to India, who traveled. You know Niccolo Conti, the Italian. He came to the Vijayanagar Raj Empire. And probably his accounts are very, very significant and systematic than our own historians and our own records who just wrote about Vijayanagar Empire. That's an important thing. Two persons who didn't come to India, one, both Greeks. One was Ptolemy. He wrote about the Pallav rule and the Python. And then other person was Plutarch. He was also a historian. Plutarch was a Greek historian, and probably his records and his writings are the detailed accounts of Alexander's invasion, his retreat, his attacks, all those things, then his return, and the whole account of the Indo-Bactrians. That is very important, that Indo-Bactrians are those people who returned with Alexander, but they did not go back to Macedonia or to Greece. Rather, they settled in Central Asia. They regularly attacked India, captured some parts like Punjab, Kashmir, even this up to Mathura, and some of them became Buddhists, some of them became this Shaiv, and some of them also became Vaishnavs. So this account, this will be a question that how far they are important, the foreigner's account or the traveler's account, and you'll write that these are very important. The second thing is, you may agree with me or may not agree with me, India was not a unified state before the coming of the British, or before the British established one unified state in India. I'll give you one example. In 1955, Nehru asked the great geophysicist Meghna Sahaji that you prepare a calendar, Indian calendar, not the Gregorian one, Indian calendar for India, so that we can use it for official purposes. Saha collected 6 persons and formed a committee. Now, what he found, that in India there are 30 calendars already. We had many Chakravartis, we had many Vikramadits, and we had Lakshman Sen, a Bengal ruler who was defeated by Bakhtiar Khilji. He had also his calendar. Harshvardhan, the king of Kannauj, earlier Thaneshwar, he also had a calendar started in 606. Chandragupta II, Vikramadit, he had also his calendar. So naturally, what has happened, because of this regional rulers and not a unified state, the regions in India are very important. The regions in India are very important. And those regions have tried to maintain their identity. So, somewhat in a funny manner, I use that India is new and regions are old. The Utkal region, very old. Although Utkal has the credit that there was a Megha Burman Raja, Kharwel founder, his queen in the 2nd century BC or AD, probably, she had a cave, just writings. For the first time, this Hathi Gumpha means elephant cave. Hathi is elephant, Gumpha is the cave. In this elephant cave, there is an inscription, Bharat Varsh. Probably the first description in the 2nd century BC or 2nd century AD. So the idea of India has been there for thousands of years. The idea of India is there for thousands of India. India may not be a United States, and India had different regions, and those regions were definitely. So what we find, that the southerner kings had not come down to the upper areas. Only one king, Rajendra Chol, he conquered Bengal, and he just had a title, Gangai, victory, Gangai Chol. So naturally, but there were many Chalukya kings, Pulkeshin too, who defeated Harshvardhan. Even he did not come to the northern area and to just conquer these areas. Samudragupta went to far south, conquered the whole of South India, but it did not integrate that region. So naturally that kind of regions have remained very, very important, and their identity is also very important. Very often, in a lighter vein, I say that there are hundreds of regional festivals. I say a festival is that period or that occasion when people have some good food in their house. So these people say that, no work today, I'll have only this murga bhat and murga chawal, only this chicken curry and rice, nothing else. So we do have only two Indian festivals. They'll say, no sir, 26th January is there, 15th August is there. Aray, how many people cook pulao on 15th August? Not many, only in the government offices. Regional festivals, in South India there Onam, there Pongal and all that. In Odisha there Makar Sankrant, Ratha Yatra. In Bengal, they are almost mad at the time of pujas. So, All India festivals, two. One is 1st January, New Year. Whole of India, from the beggars to the truck drivers to the school children, they have a picnic day on 1st January. That's a national festival. Second is 14th February. How much we may not like it, but this love day has become a national festival. And the more, because the more the women are freer, that would become a kind of a festival in future. Even today, this has acquired a kind of a color of this a national festival. So, this regional identities, and I say that they have not moved to those areas. I'm coming on to that. The third thing is, the speciality of Indian culture is that we have great diversity. Great diversity. If you move all over India, you'll be surprised to see people in Assam and the people in Punjab always trying to just dance and always trying to, whatever they are doing, they are very jovial, very active. Go south, always in a musical mood. The kind of dress they wear, that's very typical because they don't have any winter season there. So naturally, this whole of India has much of diversity. This diversity, Nehru commented that this is also a question very often you may expect, that many great civilizations, the civilization of Babylon, the civilization of Sumer, a contemporary of Indus culture, a civilization of Egypt, the civilization of Aztec, the civilization of Rome, the civilization of Ahome, the Central African civilization, the civilization of Maya, even all those civilizations have declined. They could not continue. But Indian culture and civilization has continued for the last 5,000 years uninterrupted. What is the secret behind this? The secret is that in India, we have accommodated with diversity. We are going to Kashi, we are going to Banaras, we are worshipping the same gods, but not interacting with each other. This interaction does not matter, but simply we accommodate that he is worshipping in a different way and I am worshipping in a different way. Nehru said that we have continued so long and for 5,000 years because we have accepted this diversity, we have accommodated with this diversity. This has been there. Now the question is, after all, why this diversity is there? What is the reason? So the reason of diversity is that different people from different areas have come to India. As late as 1028 AD, the Ahoms, a tribe from Thailand, they came to India. Since the these Ahoms could not pronounce hatch, they pronounce H for S. So Ahom became Assam. The secret behind the name Assam is the Ahom tribe, they came to India in 1028. Now, as far as others are concerned, probably Persia is, or Iran, present-day Iran, is the great source or the greatest source of people who have come to India from Persia, ancient Persia. The Parthians came to India. Parthians are called in India as Pallav or Pahlav. These Pahlavs came from western area. They just fought with each other and they then settled in South India. They established their rule in all the Madura region. That's Pahlavs. And I have told you about the Ptolemy, and their capital was Paithan area, Maharashtra area. They dominated the whole of. Today what is happening? In 1931, one of our B.S. Guha, anthropologist, when he tried to find out the racial distribution of India, he found that Tamil Nadu and Kerala has the largest racial elements of these Parthians. One time Persians, now then. The second are the so-called famous Sak rulers. Sak were called as Scythians. Those Scythians also came from Persia, Iran. Now, there have been many people, the Sakas are very, very warrior people, and they have been defeated by many. Chandragupta too defeated them. Then even our Vakatak rulers defeated. Before that, the Satavahan rulers defeated them. But then now, according to Guha, their major finding or remains have been found in Maharashtra and parts of Karnataka. So this is one reason of the diversity we have today in India. India is not the most diverse country in the world. The most diverse country in the world is USA. USA is the most diverse country. But our diversity is also not less. We are also very diverse. The most homogeneous country in the world is France. Very, very similar. France is the most homogeneous country in the world. It has very little diversity, no differences, and they are almost one. The French people are, great people. And though those French people are so sentimental, so emotional, once they start laughing, they laugh for 2 days. Once they start dancing, they dance for 7 days. In 1998, they won the World Cup, Football World Cup. Even this year, last year, they won the Football World Cup. Last time, in 1998, they danced and danced and danced for 7 days. Ultimately, the government had to declare an emergency that if within 24 hours you do not join the duties, your services will be terminated. This year, 2018, they won the World Cup. The French government was ready. No more than 48 hours for dancing. So, these emotional people, you know that in history, the French people were always very great people. They called the Germans till 1750 barbarians. This is history. And the Germans have emerged as an intellectual, as a violent, very brave society only after 1750, the feeling of nationalism when it emerged there. Now, this diversity is because of the coming of different people from China. Yuzi tribe, you must have heard the name of Kanishk. That Kanishk, his forefathers had come from China. He became a Buddhist and organized the fourth Buddhist council in Kashmir. And that Mahayan was established from that period itself. So very often there is a misconception that Mahayan was responsible for Buddhist decline. Even in China, Kashyap Matang, an Indian Buddhist saint, he went to China, carried the message of Buddha to China, and the whole of China became this Mahayan Buddhist. But the Hinayana and Mahayana are equally distributed. But I said, take another example, Huns. Who were they? Huns were also Chinese. The great Gupta dynasty was destroyed by these Huns. They are so ferocious, so brutal, but also so brave. They were the world's best archers. They defeated any army they encountered. So this also. Then the Arabs came to India, the Turks, the Mughals were Turks. The Turks came to India, the Greeks came to India, and a large whole one. Our Buddha in the Gandhar art, you find him a good Greek god. When he is just depicted in Mathura, he becomes somewhat half Greek, half Indian. And when he is depicted in Amaravati, he becomes a South Indian hero like Rajinikanth. So naturally, that is also a feature. I am coming on to that. But diversity has been also consolidated by our regional rulers. These regional rulers, the Chalukyas, they ultimately came to Gujarat, became Solankis, and they tried to maintain this distinction of Gujarat. They tried to maintain the distinction of the Tamils. So they say that no, we are Tamilians, and we are just proud that we are Tamilians. As far as the fourth feature is concerned, in India, we all Indians are religious people. We have our religions, and we have these religions which are very important. So culture in India has always followed a religious pattern. Indus culture, we see the worship of Mother Goddess. And in this, again, what we find that when we move on to this later Vedic period, when Buddhism emerged, the whole culture is organized around the Buddhist and the Jain religions. So this cultural division and this cultural orientation has been following a regional, this kind of a religious pattern. Later on also, when this Brahminical revival occurred, and there was this Shaivism and this Bhagavatism, and then later on the Sakt and the Saurya, they also had their own cultural distinction. Different regions have different religious features, and different religions are dominating the whole of cultural system. Then as far as the fifth is concerned, that we have these regional varieties. Mostly we divide India into Northern India, then the Deccan. Deccan is what? Deccan is south of Narmada and north of Krishna rivers. This is called a Deccan region. Mostly the western part. And then there is the far south of the Tungabhadra river, is called the far south. Write this, write this. Let you write that Indian cultural history has five important features. Number one, is we don't have a tradition of history writing. We don't have a tradition of history writing. And we don't have, even now the people say that Indians are, or eulogists, they give more importance to their own culture. Bharat is Mahan, even if we are not Mahan, or we are not the most important super, or that kind of thing. So we didn't have, right, we didn't have a tradition of history writing. Therefore, we depend on the accounts of foreign travelers and the scholars from different countries. The travelers like Fa Hien, T. Sang, then Huan Sang, travelers like Niccolo Conti, travelers like Abdul Razzaq, they have their accounts. Then the historians like Plutarch, a Greek, and then Ptolemy, again a Greek. Ptolemy, again a Greek. Their accounts provide us. He is a Greek historian. He gave the account of Alexander's this march to India or invasion to India. Ptolemy has written about the Pallavs. Ptolemy has written about the Pallavs. So they didn't come to India, but they are foreign scholars, foreign historians. This man, Huan Sang's account of 2,000 pages is a very important account, right? His account gives us the information about the Harsha period and the India of 7th century. India of 7th century. Number two, India did not have a unified state before the coming of the British. There were 30 calendars and more than 4,000 kings when Britishers came to India. Yeah. because of this lack of unified state, we have a regional communities. Number three, India is a diverse country. Nehru said that this diversity is the cause of India's continuity as a great culture or as a unified civilization for 5,000 years. This diversity is because of two regions. One, people have come from different regions. Thailand, China, then the Turkish, the Arabs, the Greeks, and the Persians came. Pallav and Shak are very important. The second region is the regional rulers wanted to maintain their regional identity. The regional rulers wanted to maintain their regional identity, like the Choles, the Chalukyas, the Bengal or the Gaur rulers, number fourth. The fourth special feature in India is it's a country of religious people, and culture has always veered around, organized around different religions. Culture has veered, V-E-R-E-D, veered, organized around religions. In Indus culture, mother goddess was supreme. Indus culture, mother goddess was supreme. In the later Vedic period, the Vedic gods were supreme. After the emergence of Buddhism and Jainism, the Vedic gods were supreme or more important. Buddhism and Jainism, full of the Buddhist culture or Jain culture. Then after them Shaivism, Bhagavatism, Krishna, Vasudev, Vishnu, all that. The sun god, the goddess, and Ganapatai. What is this Ganapatai? The worship of Ganesh. The whole of Maharashtra is just organized around the worship of Ganesh. Later on, when Islam came to India, that whole culture became Indo-Islamic culture. When the Portuguese came to India, they tried to just have the Christianity. So right, the fifth thing. In India, there are different broad regions. Number one is North India. Number two is Deccan. This Deccan is south of the Narmada river and north of Krishna river. South of Narmada river and north of Krishna river. Mostly there are three parts of this Deccan. One is Malwa, now in Madhya Pradesh. Another is Maharashtra and another is Karnataka. These three are the Deccan areas. Deccan areas. Then we say South India. This South India is from this Tungabhadra to the southernmost tips. Now, these broad regions have followed different cultural patterns. These broad regions have followed different cultural patterns. So, from this, what I have told you, there can be four questions. They have come. One is, and I don't write, but remember in this mind. One is the importance of the foreign traveler's account. This is one question. The second question is that how far that diversity of India has been maintained, and then what is the source of unity? I give you only one example, that Hathi Gumpha cave, that inscription, the Bharat Varsh, idea of India has been always there. So, the third question is that the regional identities and the regional features. And the fourth question is that came also, that the basic features of Hinduism have not been corroded by the influence of different bhakti movements or different movements in India. This clear? These all questions have come in UPSC, and there are chances that the one question have been repeated thrice. So this is, now we begin the story of this. A story of Indian culture in the context of Indian history. This story is, we begin with the Mesolithic period. What is this Mesolithic? The Middle Stone Age. Middle Stone Age remains have been found in three broad areas in India. south of the Narmada river in the mountain areas, then south of Kashmir, the Sohan Valley, and then Chotnagpur, present Jharkhand areas. Mesolithic or the middle stone is human beings or the Homo sapiens sapiens. They did not evolve in India. The majority opinion is this. Man has come from outside to India and then they settled. As far as these human beings are concerned, they settled in different parts, but first in northwestern India. Mesolithic period is important for two things. One is that the microliths, small stone implements, were very, very beautiful, and their aesthetic value is still par excellent. Even today in India, we don't have, rarely we have such fine instruments or such fine stone instruments, the kind of needle. So because of these fine instruments, what happened, they created a kind of thing that for the first time they used the skin covers from leather, they used this. The second thing is that in this Mesolithic period, they lived in caves, in groups, to protect them from the sun or to protect them from the rains or protect them from the wild animals. In these caves, they started cave paintings. We find the cave paintings in Vidisha, we find the cave paintings in Chotnagpur, we find the cave paintings in Sohan Valley also. This is a fact. After this Mesolithic, this was a question in 2014, how Mesolithic period had such aesthetic features, such aesthetic fineries. Then we jump on to Neolithic, a new stone age. The new stone age remains have been found all over India, from the south Kerala areas to the easternmost areas. The Neolithic means new stone age. Neolithic was famous or important for four things. What? Number one is domestication of animal. Number two is agriculture or cultivation. Cultivation is started, agriculture is started in the Neolithic period. That is why it is called as the Neolithic Revolution. This is called as Neolithic Revolution or the New Stone Age Revolution. Why? Because domestication of animal started and this agriculture started. But the third speciality is what? For the first time, human beings started settling in the plain areas outside the cave in the villages. Small hamlet villages started from that area. And the fourth thing is, the Neolithic people were the first people where they had some kind of a social existence or societal existence, not before that. So, you have to prepare about Neolithic and find that the Neolithic revolution was important because of these four things. We jump on to another theme, because I am just introducing you to these topics. The Indus culture is called as the Chalcolithic culture. Chalco means copper. Chalco is copper. Lithic is stone. Copper and stone. But that transitioned to this bronze also. Basically a bronze culture. It's a fact. Basically a bronze culture. Now, you all know that Indus culture was very important, and in certain areas or certain aspects, even today in India, today in India, we cannot match them. What is that? Town planning. All other things, Indus was famous for many things. This Indus culture did not have two things. They didn't have iron, they didn't have horse. They didn't have iron and they did not have horse. And probably it was the horse which led to their defeat in subsequent years, subsequent period. But as far as the Indus culture is concerned, that Indus culture was a contemporary of the Sumerians. Sumer culture, present the Iraq, that and so that Sumer culture was a contemporary of the Indus culture. They had all the things. Sumerians had the agriculture was there. The Sumerians have that kind of city. It was also a city civilization. Sumer, India was also, this Indus was also a city civilization. But the unique thing was the town planning of the Indus people. The exactly this rectangular roads, wide roads, right moving roads, and then the two quarters, quarters of the slaves and the quarters of the masters. Those were very different, and the covered drains is still in Delhi. We don't have all the drains which are covered. So naturally, this thing was there. So after the Indus, we jump on to that Vedic period. Vedic period is divided into two periods. One is the Rig Vedic. Only Rig Veda was composed in verses. No script was there, but this had letter compilations also, letter collections also. Then the letter Vedic period, a very, very important literary period, because the Atharved, the Samved, Yajurved, up to the Upanishads. After the Vedas, there were Brahmans. What are these Brahmans? Interpretations of some of the Vedic Suktas. Then after the Brahmans, there are Aranyaks. These Aranyaks probably were composed in forests. And these Aranyaks were interpretations in philosophical terms. And then the Upanishads. Upanishad is called as Vedant. The end of the Vedas, the end of the Vedas. There is an important thing about the Upanishads. Other Vedic texts were composed by Brahmins. Upanishads were mostly composed by Kshatriya saints. So there were two things. Upanishad is based on the philosophy of karma. Vedas are based on the philosophy of meditation. They said tapa is force, meditation is the force. And they said, the Upanishad says, no, the work is important thing, the karma is important thing. That was a very important feature. Now, what happened? That this period, 6th century BC, was a world revolution. Why do I say this world revolution? In India, there was Gautam Buddha, there was Mahavir, there was this Makkhali Ghosal. Makkhali Ghosal started a new religion of the Ajiviks. Ajivik was a religion, and the Buddhist sources say that there were more than 160 religions in the 6th century BC. We know in detail, and they continued. One is the Buddhist religion and another is the Jain religion.
So 160 is across the world or in India?
Sir? No, only in India. In India. So as far as I say that the world revolution, why I say this world revolution? In China, who was there? China.
Shintoism
was somewhat started in Japan and then it went to China. So the Confucius was there. Confucius, the great Confucius, was there in China in 6th century BC. And another person was Lao Tzu. He was there in 6th century BC. Theremia, a man in Palestinian, he started. Then this our Zoroastrian, he was there in the 6th century BC. So even in Rome, even in Europe, even in Palestinian. So this world revolution, why this world revolution occurred? Because iron was used for the first time in agriculture. Iron was invented in the 10th century BC. But at that time, from 10th century BC to 6th century BC, this was used only for warfare, for weapons. But after the 6th century, it was used for agriculture. And its use in agriculture led to huge agricultural production, because hard rock can be cultivated now. Hard rock through these iron implements could be cultivated, and it gave tremendous production, and trade emerged. We see that Gautam Buddha preached to 5 persons in Sarnath. All those 5 persons were traders. All those 5 persons were traders. Within 80 years, Assi Saal, within 80 years, Buddhism is spread to almost whole of Asia. It could not go to Africa, it could not go even to Europe, but the whole of Asia, today's Pakistan, today's Afghanistan, today's West Asia, the whole of China, the whole of Southeast Asia, they all become Buddhists. You know that Buddhism and Jainism, both are such religions which do not have any conception of God. No God. So mostly they are called as heterodox religions. Heterodox religions. Shankaracharya, he said, my one purpose of life is to finish these atheists, the Jains and the Buddhists. So naturally, but Buddhism was a great revolution in India, because Gautam said, extremes are not good thing. We should adopt the Madhyamarg, the middle path. The middle path should not involve in luxuries and should not wait in idleness. So Buddhism and Jainism, those religions, when they emerged in 80 years, whole of India almost was covered by Buddhism. Then the Brahmin religion, or the Brahmins, a great genius people, they devised a new thing. Buddhism adopted which language? Pali language, the language of the people. Jainism adopted which language? Prakrit language, the common man's language. But Brahminism and Hinduism, Sanskrit was. Sanskrit is a great language, a very powerful language, and a very developed grammar it has. But then it was never the language of the people, never the language of the common masses. So definitely this Buddha and this Mahavir, they adopted the more common languages. When these things happened, so what happened, or what Hinduism did, they tried to develop a kind of a new religion. So there were 3 changes. Number one, common language, the regional languages, the local languages developed as the language of Bhagavatism, Krishna, the languages of this Shaiv preachers. And the second thing is, they started the bhakti movement, the personalized gods. Personalized gods. Shiva is my god, that Shakti is my god. This kind of thing happened. And the third thing, that when they developed these local languages, the regional languages also grew. So it was the 6th century BC from which the regional languages have started. This Tamil is a very old language. It started in 10th century BC, but as far as Malayali is concerned, as far as Kannad is concerned, as far as Telugu is concerned, they developed in the 6th century BC itself. Write this up to all, but write fast. So I'll just give you the outline. The story of Indian culture begins from the Mesolithic period. Mesolithic is important for two things. One, the microliths or small stone implements, stone implements they had, or they were very beautiful and artistic. The second thing, they lived in caves, and so for the first time cave painting started in India. Their remains have been found south of Narmada, Chotnagpur Plateau, and south of Kashmir in the Swan Valley. Swan Valley. The Neolithic or the New Stone Age was a revolution because it started domestication of animal and agriculture. Animal husbandry or animal rearing and agriculture. Number three, they started village life. And number four, developed social organization. Then the next phase, important phase, is Indus culture. Indus was basically mother goddess worship region. It was a city culture. It had all the achievements in town planning, which makes it unique. Covered drains, wide roads, and right angle turns . Indus did not have two things, the horse and the iron. The horse and the iron. After Indus, the important phase is later Vedic period. This later Vedic period witnessed the Magadh Empire. You all know that there are 16 Mahajanpads. Out of the 16 Mahajanpad, there was Mats, there was Vats, there was Koshal, there was Kosambi, there was Ang, there was Magadh, all those. The Magadhan kingdom was very important because it had kings like Bimbisar, a very, very diplomatic person, married 10 wives and captured all the kingdoms of his wives, Ajatasatru. They are all father killers. Bimbisar killed his father. Ajatasatru also killed his father. Ajatasatru met Gautam Buddha, said, "Lord, I have committed many crimes." He said, "All right, whatever you have committed, it's all right. But from now on, you don't commit any crimes." And probably it is true that he did not commit any crimes any longer. Magadh Empire ultimately gave birth to the Mauryans. Mahapadmananda king, Padmananda was killed by Chandragupta and he established the Mauryan Empire. Now, in the Mauryan Empire, as I have told you, I'll just tell you. The later Vedic's important achievement is Mauryan Empire, in which Ashoka was the greatest figure. Ashoka did 5 things: the pillars, then the caves, the vihars, the stoops and the chaitas. It's such a way, because you have to read Ashoka that I say. I'm just telling you that these are the important things. Five things. His contributions: number one, pillars. Pillar. How many pillars? More than 4,000 pillars, probably. Only 12 or 13 are remaining right now, all have been destroyed. But it is said that he constructed, as far as the Buddhist sources are concerned, he constructed more than 4,000 pillars. And those pillars were there even in this Persian culture. But those pillars were multi-stone pillars. Ashokan pillars are single stone pillars. That's the great difference. And so the first thing is pillar. The second thing is caves in Bihar, Barabar caves, all those caves. Number three is Bihar. The Bihar. What is this Bihar?
Resting houses of monks.
Shraman Buddhism was a great revolution because Buddhism created a whole lot of Shramans. Those people who devoted their whole life to the preaching of Buddhist religion. So those Shramans were the greatest contribution, because when Pushyamitra Sung established his rule, he said, "Kill one Shraman and take 1,000 taka." Pushyamitra Sung's teacher was Patanjali. The great Patanjali was his teacher. And Patanjali is famous for Mahabhashya and other texts. So, I said three things have happened. One is the pillar, second is the caves, the third is the vihar, the fourth is the stupa. Stoop, Sanchi stoop, was constructed by Ashoka. And the fifth are chaityas, the place of worship. Chaityas are place of worship. You must expect a question: Ashoka's achievements in archaeology, in culture. Expect a question: Ashokan achievements in culture, Ashokan achievements in culture. Right, that Buddhism and Jainism were contemporary religion and they had almost revolutionized Indian society. And right, because of the success of Buddhism and Jainism, the Brahmin religion innovated three things. Number one, local language. Number two, personalized gods. And the bhakti movement. And number three, incorporation of regional gods. Incorporation of regional gods. So, there are three things I want to mention. That number one is that because of this contact with the Greeks, what happened? That after this Maurya ruler, Brihadrat was the last Maurya ruler. He was killed by Pushyamitra Shunga. And then a Shunga dynasty, the Brahma dynasty was started, established. But in his period, after that Pushyamitra Shunga, there were the Kanwa rulers. Vasudeva was the man who killed one of the Shunga dynasty rulers. And then this after the Kanwa rulers, the Satvahans or the Andhra rulers started their rule. But in the period of the Shunga dynasty itself, what happened? That those people who had come with Alexander and had settled in Central Asia, what they are called? They are called as Indo-Bactrians. They are called as Indo-Bactrians. So these Indo-Bactrians regularly attacked India. Ankios, he captured whole of this Gandhar. Then this Democritus, he controlled and he captured whole of Punjab. Then this Demetrius, our Mahendra or Milind, he also captured the south of the Punjab regions. Milind is a very important person. Meander is his name. He entered into an argument with the great Buddhist scholar Nagarjuna. Now that debate has been written in a book form. And what is the name of that book? Milind Panho. Milind Panho. It's a great book because it gives an idea of that period society in those areas. Now because of this contact, what happened? A particular form of art started. What is that? Gandhar art. Gandhar is presently in Peshawar. This area, the Gandhar art is famous for three things. It is more Greek than Indian. Buddha has been painted and has been erected as a Greek god. Curly hair, like the Greek people, a very, very handsome man. Buddha has been, his clothing is a majestic, very saintly looking clothes and saintly looking posture. eyes are shut, mostly Buddha eyes are shut. So then it was this impact of Greek culture that in one place, Mathura, now a great Vaishnav center, today Krishna center is there. So in Mathura what happened, that a Mathura art developed. This Mathura art was somewhat different. Even there Buddha was there, but now Buddha was sensuous, not saintly, rather more human, more worldly. He had ornaments and he wears, he looks like an Indian prince. Then the third place is Amaravati. Amaravati is present in Andhra Pradesh. It's being developed as the capital. Now in that period also, in that time, around 2nd century AD, there was the Amaravati art. Amaravati art has some Indian gods. Shiva is there, Krishna is there, Vishnu is there, and along with Buddha is also there. So this development of Buddha there, we find that there is more just incorporation of different religions. So this can be a question. This can be a question of yours. Write about this Gandhar art and differentiate between the Gandhar art and Mathura art. Gandhar art and the Mathura art. So after this, as we told you the story up to this 6th century BC, from the 6th century BC to the 6th century AD to 10th century AD, there were in South India two important bhakti movements. Their power and their influence was so great that it continued for 400 years. One was organized around the worship of Shiva. Those were called as Nayanar saints. Nayanar was the Shaiva people. They had also great singers, great poets, and others were called as Alwars. Alwars, the Vishnu devotees, they also, in the Alwar bhakti people, there was a lady, Amala. She was a great poet and she was a great singer. Now what happened in South India at that time, there was a violent clash between the Shaivas and between the Vaishnavas. In this clash, who emerged victorious? The Shaivas emerged victorious. So the predominant religion of South India is the Shaiva religion. There are no doubt the Vishnu, and there are the even goddesses are there. Durga Mata Mandir is there near Bangalore. But the dominant stream is of this. Now this bhakti movement, this bhakti movement has different strands and different varieties in India. But first write this. So the impact of Indo-Bactrians, who were Greek people settled in Central Asia. They regularly attacked Indian areas and captured from northwest to Magadh regions. This interaction led to three art forms. One is Gandhar, located in today's Pakistan, in this there is Greek influence, then the Mathura, where half Indian, half Greek, and then Amaravati, where more Indian and less Greek, more Indian and less Greek. In all of them, Buddha is the central figure. In all of them, Buddha is the central figure. In Amaravati, there is Shiva, there is Vishnu, and there are Yakshinis or women gatekeepers. Yakshinis, women gatekeepers. Yaksh means, Yaksh is male and Yakshini is female, but Yakshinis are there in Amaravati, not male Yaksh is there. So that was a kind of a symbolic of the female goddess, that they were important. In India, throughout Indian history, women have been an object of worship. We have in Hinduism, I'm coming on to that, five basic denominations. The largest is the Vaishnavas, North India, Northwest India. Second is Shaivas, Shiva, Shaiva, South India and Central India, even this Eastern India. Then the third are the Shakti worshippers. Why Bengal has so much of Durga Puja? Because they are Shakti worshippers. Then the sun worshippers. You see every year at the time of Chhat, Biharis dying while going to Bihar for Chhat Puja. What is this Chhat Puja? This is nothing but the worship of sun god. And the fifth is Ganapati, the worship of the Maharashtra, that region is the worship of Ganesh. So these are the five major denominations. Write this. In South India, from 6th century AD to 10th century AD, there was powerful bhakti movement. This movement had two sections, the Shiva worshippers were called Nayanars and the Vishnu worshippers were called as Alwars. Shiva Nayanar and Vishnu the Alwars. They had classes for long periods, and ultimately the Shaiv emerged victorious in South India. Ultimately the Shaiv became victorious in South India.
What is Shaiv?
SHAIVA, from Shiva Shaiva. From Shiva Shaiva. The denomination is called a Shaiva denomination, Shaiva denomination, the worshippers of Shiva. Shiva is probably much older than Vishnu. Shiva is rarely referred in Vedic texts. Vishnu is a Vedic god, and as far as this Indus culture had a horn god. In South India, Shiva is called as Murugan, and Murugan very often is depicted as that kind of a god. So it is said that this is an extension of the South, this Indus god, the horn god. This horn god of South India is there, and that has been projected. Pasupata is a different, then it is a 10th century development. It's a 10th century development. But these are the five denominations which are there in India, and we have very important Hindu denominations. Now, what I am trying to say and emphasize, that the bhakti movement, this religious worshipping movement in India, had two trends from the early period. One is the syncretic trend, that means combining all gods. So the trend of Nanak, the trend of Kabir, the trend of these people. So even Shankar Dev, probably we have not heard of the name of Shankar Dev. He was a 16th century saint of Assam. In this 16th century saint Shankar Dev, he almost totally changed the context of South India. Almost totally changed the context of this Assam. How? Only one region in India where there is no untouchability. That is Assam. No untouchability even today. All go to everybody's house, they enter the house. Whose contribution is this? It is the contribution of Shankar Dev. The area, the center of Devi, the center of Shakti, the Guwahati temple, this temple of there, it's one of the great centers of Shakti. But whole of Assam, it does not have many temples. Every village has a Namghar. In this Namghar or this worship center, there is a room, it's all clean. Probably there is a book of Shiva recitals. So what happened? Shankar Dev preached, all human beings are equal human beings. All are the disciples of Shankar. None else. Shankar is supreme. This is nothing new. What Shankaracharya said, Advait philosophy. No duality, no division, but only one, and that one is Shiva. And Shiva is the only god in Hinduism. He tried to establish it, and he established four dhams, four peaks. This Badrinath, one peak, then south Sringeri, then west Dwarka, and east is Puri. So he tried, he wanted to establish the supremacy of Shiva. But Shankaracharya was somewhat sectarian. He didn't want to see others. He didn't want to see this heterodox religions. No, no Buddhism, no Jainism, all. Everybody should be worshipper of Shiva. Now, as far as Shankar Dev is concerned, he said, no, all are equal and all should be respected. And the third thing he said, man as well as woman should participate in every activity. Probably Assam is the only state where in most cases it is female who proposes marriage. Are, mere se shaadi karega? Will you marry me, the scoundrel? So naturally this kind of thing happens. Why this happens? Because women are relatively free. I am really surprised that we don't have so many women leaders from Assam. But in general, Assamese women are more freer. That area has freer women. And whose contribution is this? This is the contribution of Shankar Dev. There was a question in UPSC that the Bhakti movement could not affect the basic structure of Hindu religion. You will contest this. No, it affected. Because there was Guru Nanak. Guru Nanak did what? Guru Nanak started a religion, and that religion was Sikh religion. Now, a new religion, a kind of, although later on the Mughals and the Sikhs had a very, very bitter enmity. But who was the greatest partner of this Nanak? His name was Mardana. And Mardana, Nanak sang and Mardana had the instrument Pakhawa, something like that. So, after the death of Mardana, Nanak assured his family that so long I am alive, I will take care of your family. Nanak lived where? Nankana Sahib. Where it is? Just beside the Ravi River, on the borders of India and Pakistan. And this great Sidhuji became famous by going there, Pakistan, and embracing Imran Khan and that general of army, Pakistan army, and then he always is in controversy, and he is a great person that way. A Sidhu is great, and so he is punch and in other things. But what I say, that this affected, Bhakti movement affected Hindu religion, and it had developed different. Kabir and his followers have become somewhat less important now. But he also started Kabir Panthis. The Kabir Panthis are a different sect. So, on the other hand, Surdas was there. Other hand, Tulsidas was there. Tulsidas in the 16th century composed a Mahakavya, an epic, Ramcharitmanas. By this Ramcharitmanas, he injected a sense of confidence among the Hindus, because at that time Hinduism was in a decline. Akbar was the ruler and Akbar was trying to devise new religions. So write this. The Bhakti movement in the later period had two trends. One was syncretic or liberal, and another was sectarian or conservative. Sectarian or conservative. There are more people who were sectarian, like Ramanujacharya, like Surdas, like Tulsidas, who by writing Ramcharitmanas introduced a sense of confidence among the Hindus, the syncretic trend had Kabir, had Nanak, had Dadu, And also a man in Assam, Shankar Dev. This syncretic movement produced a new religion, Sikhism, by Nanak. And Shankar radically changed Assam society. This Assamese society developed, number one, no statue worshipping. Number two, worship of Shiva as the universal God. And the encouragement to women to participate in all religious activities. These religious movements impacted the Hindu religion enormously, and radically changed it. So again we go back to much earlier. We had come to the 16th century, we are going back to the 2nd century AD, to the Guptas. Gupta rulers, their rule is called as the golden age in India. Now, what is the argument for this golden age? The most important argument is that they had the highest number or highest reservoir of the gold coins. Very true, that the Gupta rule had many achievements. The Gupta rule was a revival of Hinduism, composition of Mahabharata as one whole text, and because the story of Mahabharata is there even in Rig Veda as Bija Samhita. That is the same story of the Mahabharata, but this was for the first time. Chatusvarna was established for the first time in the Gupta time. Chatusvarna. Caste system emerged in Gupta period from 5th century AD. It didn't exist before that. Caste system did not exist before that. It emerged in 5th century AD and the Gupta time. So the Guptas established a large kingdom, and there were great warriors. Samudragupta, he almost conquered the whole of India and had his inscription by Harisen, his minister, and Allahabad. Inscription of Allahabad, detailed in writing form, that what were the areas, what they did, what were their religion. And this was the religion, this was the period when Indian society tried to just have a kind of a unified structure. Could not do it, but it tried to do it. Gupta, this was a question. Numismatics, what is this?
Coins.
Yeah, that is 100% right. Numismatics, numismatics means the science of coins. All coins were definitely punch marked coins. Punch marked, some head, some figure is just this embossed there, and that seems there. Now, the Guptas had three special things. Number one, large number of gold coins. Mostly they were kept as a kind of a source of asset. The second, different types of coins. There was bronze coins, copper coins, there was coins also. And the third is that their coins had the greatest variety in India. No ruler in India had as many types of coins as the Guptas had. Yes, the Guptas were ultimately defeated by who and how they declined. They are very liberal people. Nalanda was not established by them. Nalanda was established by the Buddhist rulers. But they contributed at the time of Skandagupta enormously to Nalanda University. It became almost four times larger at the time of Skandagupta. So, what we say that the Gupta rulers were important in many respects. They tried to establish a new Indian society, thus maintain an Indian society, and they had their contacts even to the Prabhavati was the daughter of Chandragupta I. She was married to Rudradaman, a Satavahan ruler, and they had different relations. So, a kind of an all India image, an all India unification was there at the time of Guptas. So, write this. The Gupta dynasty, either Ghatotkach or Sri Gupta, I mean there are two persons who are credited with starting the Gupta dynasty. One is Sri Gupta, another is Ghatotkach. It's not very clear who started it. They had their capital in Pataliputra. Samudragupta conquered almost the whole of India. Chandragupta II, Vikramaditya, extended and established a federal state, giving autonomy to different regions. The Gupta rule was famous for many things. Number one, large number of gold coins and diverse coins in gold, silver, copper, bronze and other alloys. They all were punch marked. And they had not only the king's name on them, but different symbols also. In numismatics, probably no other dynasty can match the achievement of the Gupta dynasty. Second, number two, this was the period of Brahman or Hindu revival after the decline of Buddhism. And mostly they established Vaishnav religion. Number three, the Varna system was established and caste as a distinct institution started from the Gupta period. Caste system started as a distinct organization from that period. Next, Mahabharata in its present form was composed in the Gupta dynasty. Next, probably feudalism in India started with the Guptas. Feudalism in India started with the Guptas, and this feudalism was based on land grants. This feudalism was based on land grants. Ultimately, Gupta rulers were liberal rulers who donated and renovated the Buddhist University of Nalanda. The Hun invaders were responsible for their decline. The Hun invaders were responsible for their decline. Hun. Actually, if I happen, so the Hunas, these Huns were great archers. They could kill a person probably from 500 yards. They were such good archers. And even women archers were there along with them. They were probably from China. They are very cruel people and very ferocious. Probably it is said that they kill all males in the Pataliputra region. Only women remained. They killed all men. So they came from China, settled for some time, 200 years in Central Asia, and from there they attacked. Ultimately, probably it is said that the present day Rajputs of Rajasthan or Northern India are the descendants of these Huns. It is said. No, it is very much an historical fact. Probably it is said that they are the people. Because the Rajputs are also very brave, and Rajputs are also very brave people. So these Huns were responsible for their decimation. After the 5th century, there is almost no trace of the Gupta rulers and no influence of the Gupta rulers. After this period, one important ruler who had the vision of uniting whole of India, he emerged, Harshvardhan. Harshvardhan became Harshvardhan just by coincidence. His sister became widow because her husband was killed by the god king Shashank. And she became restless for some 2 years. Harshvardhan Harsh, he was the ruler of Thaneshwar, present day Haryana. He came over to Kannauj, present day Uttar Pradesh, Kannauj became, because of Harsh, the center of Indian power. And there were, you know, later period, three powers who clashed among themselves: the Pals of Bengal, the Rajputas of Maharashtra or Maniakhet, and the Pratihars and Gurjars of this Gujarat region. They clashed with each other for the control of Kannauj. So this is called the tripartite struggle. But right now, we are more concerned with this culture and less with the political history of India. So Harshvardhan did what? Harshvardhan had a vision when he came to Kannauj, recovered his sister and gave much of honor, killed this Shashank. And Shashank had almost destroyed the whole of Bodhi temple in Uruvela or Gaya. The whole temple was burnt, whole Bodhi tree was burnt by Shashank. But then again Pal rulers and Harshvardhan, they renovated it, they again resurrected it. So I said one thing, that Harsh had the vision of uniting the whole of India, including South India. He united the whole of India because from Assam, Kamrup, who was the ruler of Kamrup at that, Bhaskar Barman. Bhaskar Barman was the ruler of Assam at that period, and whole of Punjab, whole of Northern India, he controlled every area of North. He wanted to just conquer even South India. But he was defeated by a Chalukya king, Pulakeshin II. And that led to the demolition of his vision to unite India. But at the time of Harshvardhan, this man, Huyen Sang, came to India. Huyen Sang was a Buddhist preacher. He converted Harsh to Buddhism. Many people doubt it. But as far as his records are concerned, it is quite proved that he became a Buddhist. He donated much to, but he was a liberal ruler. In Allahabad, at the time of this festival, he donated to the Jains, he donated to the Vaishnavs, he donated to the Shaivs, he donated to the Buddhists also. And he constructed Vaishnav temples. In his period, there was a Buddhist conference organized in Kannauj, and that conference consolidated which religion? The Mahayana variety of Buddhism. Mahayana is a kind of a denomination of Buddhism, and it had all the, I have already said that this is not correct to say that Buddhism declined in India because it adopted Mahayana. No. China is also. Kashyap Matange was the man who carried Buddhism to China, and and it became one of the powerful religions of China. So as far as Harshvardhan is concerned, as far as this Huyen Sang is concerned, there are three things which emerged important. Number one, that different religions were there. Jains were there in South India, the Buddhists were there in South India, and even in Eastern India, and those even Vaishnav centers were there, Shakti centers were there. So a kind of a religious pluralism, and the religious pluralism was very, very constructive pluralism which existed at that time. India had different rulers, but India accommodated with different regions. And Harsh as a liberal ruler tried to establish his rule, at least in Northern India, a unified rule. But this could not continue. Just after the death of Harsh, the whole this Mokhari or this Taneshwar ruler, his kingdom was disintegrated. Right. Harsh was a ruler who had the vision of uniting whole of India. He united the whole of northern India from Punjab, Kashmir to Kamrup or Assam. He wanted to control South India, but he was defeated by Pulakeshin II, a Chalukya king, number one. Harsh was a liberal ruler and witnessed pluralist India. At his time, Jains, Buddhists, Vaishnav, Shaiv, and other religions existed. He donated to all the religions. Number two, Harsh became a Buddhist in his period. Kannauj held a conference of Mahayana Buddhism. Number three, his rule was consolidated feudalism . Number four, he himself was a poet and writer. He wrote Naganand, Ratnavali, Ratnavali. Just giving an idea that you have to read these things. Harscharit was written, Harscharita. Banbhat. Probably one of the great Sanskrit poets. Although by that time Kalidas, we do not know exactly in whose court Kalidas was there. But Kalidas hero, Agnimitra, was the son of Pushyamitra king. Agnimitra was the son of Pushyamitra king. Agnimitra loved a lady, Malavika. And Kalidas wrote the great epic Malavika Agnimitra. So the love story of this Malavika and this Agnimitra. The important thing is that whereas Agnimitra was the son, he's a prince, Malavika was an ordinary lady. She was a gardener by caste. probably as the legends are there, but extremely beautiful, extremely beautiful. And she didn't give, Agnimitra had to go for 3 years to him, her. And so you marry me, that common lady was not, he could have just captured her like many instances in India, but that is the story of at least Kalidas. So after this, what we find that after Harsh, the conditions in India, no very powerful ruler. There are the Chalukya kings were there, Chalukyas in Gujarat they established. And at that time, what happened that by 712, Arab warlord Muhammad bin Qasim attacked Sindh. And that was the beginning of the political introduction of Islam to India. As far as social introduction is concerned, that social introduction had already occurred in South India. In Kerala, Arabs came for thousands of years. When there was in Islam in Arabia, they became Muslims and they continued to come to India. They married large number of Nair women. And so what these Arabs were called? What was the common term? There was a great revolution, rebellion in this period. So that rebellion is also called as the Motawal rebellion, and that they were accepted as the son-in-laws, Mopila. Mopila means, Mopila word is a Malayali word. This means son-in-law. And so these Muslims, even today in Kerala, are called what? They are called as Mopila. Mopila means, because they married large number. There, from 7th century, of this 8th century AD, 670, there are Arab settlements there. So this Mopila people were the first people who were the first Muslims in India. Later on, these were the Sufis who preached a large number of people, and they started there. And so Muslims became a kind of a larger community in India. Now, after this kind of this Arab invasion of Sindh, later on Multan, they captured whole of Sindh, whole of Multan. This was probably a Buddhist region, and Buddhists were there in majority. They converted in later larger numbers to Islam. But the Turks, Mahmud of Ghazni, started his incursions in from 1000 to 1026. And so from there, that kind of a political Islam came to India from northwestern India. There was strong resistance in that period, but since they were warriors, horse riders, and also archers, because of the training of the Huns, ultimately Ghori established that rule, the Sultanate India. Now this Sultanate had four kingdoms, four dynasties, the Alvaris, and so these four dynasties were important in the cultural sense. Qutub Minar was constructed in memory of whom?
Muhammad Qutbuddin No, sir, but Kaki.
Yeah. Now you're right. Now, yeah. Are you, sir, you are in Delhi. Visit those areas.
Bakhtiar Kaki.
So his name is, the saint is Qutubuddin Bakhtiar Kaki. So Qutubuddin started the construction of this Qutub Minar in the memory of that saint. Still he is there. Qutubuddin Bakhtiar Kaki is there. And he is, I don't know why women are not allowed. In many of the Muslim areas, this thing is there. Even this man, a liberal, Nizamuddin Awliya, even in his tomb and shrine, women are not allowed. I don't know why. In Ajmer, that Khaja Garib Nawaz, there is an open entry of anybody, and so women also just to go there. Actually, so it was erect. Now that area, that Qutub Minar area, is a very historical place in the sense that Chandragupta too had also iron and copper plank there. A large portion is written there about the Gupta ruler. Still that iron plank is there. If you have the time, just visit it, see it, because you can just read it also. It is in Sanskrit. If you can understand Sanskrit, you can read it. And so, Delhi Sultanate Walas were great builders. Alauddin Khilji, I don't know why he has become, and he has been depicted as one of the womanizers. No, he was not a womanizer that way, although married 14 wives, but that kind of thing. He was a liberal. His teacher, Mullah Maslehuddin, was always asking him to rule India on the basis of the Sharia rules. He said, "Sir, and my lord, my whole this praja is all dhimmis, non-Muslims. How could I just apply these rules to here, these people?" Probably the only sultan who conquered the whole of India. From Kashmir to Kanyakumari, he conquered the whole of India. He had a very important, very brave general, but that general was eunuch. Malik Kafur was the name. वो बेचारा जो था जिसको हम लोग क्या कहते हिजड़ा वो जो हिजड़ा एंड ही वॉन्टेड टू ही वॉज सो पावरफुल सो द होल किंगडम वॉज कॉन्कर्ड बाय मलिक काफूर होल ऑफ साउथ इंडिया वॉज कॉन्कर्ड बाय एंड इन हीज अलाउद्दीन लास्ट टाइम ही वॉन्टेड टू कैप्चर द रूल ही कुड ही वॉज नॉट सक्सेसफुल ही कुड नॉट डू इट बट अलाउद्दीन इस्टैब्लिश्ड अ city near Delhi, that's called Siri. Siri fort and Siri was established. So that Alai Darwaja was also constructed by Alauddin. Tughlaqs and those Khaljis were also very much fond of gardens. Wherever they went, they established a garden. Tughlaq garden, Lodi gardens, all gardens. I don't know. The fascination. Probably rose puja mein gulab nahi chadhaya jata. Probably you know that in different Hindu worships, they normally do not offer this rose. They offer this marigold. Genda ka phool, ulhul ka phool, sab phool chadha denge. Parantu gulab jaldi nahi chadhane. Videshi hai ye gulab susra. ये मोहब्बत और 14 फरवरी का सिंबल जो है दिस इज अ फॉरेन थिंग फॉर देम एंड सो बट इट इज सेड दैट इट वॉज द दिल्ली सल्तनत हु ट्राइड टू डू दिस व्हेन दिल्ली सल्तनत बिकेम समवट वीक टू ब्रदर्स हरिहर एंड बुक्का दे एस्टैब्लिश्ड अ रूल in South India, in the Telugu region, the Vijayanagar Empire. The Vijayanagar Empire was a very famous empire, and that empire had a kind of a clash with the Bahmani rulers, like the two wives of a same man do it. Sautiya Da. Almost like the two wives of the same man. They clashed and clashed and clashed and clashed, always for a single piece of land. What was that land? Tungabhadra Doab. Doab. This is called Doab. Tungabhadra Doab. This Tungabhadra Doab was the plain land, very fertile land, very fertile land. and for which they clashed like cats and dogs. Vijayanagar Empire had a great cultural contribution because they had a temple city of Hampi. There is another temple, it's more beautiful temples right now, even there. So this Krishnadev Rai, one of the very famous rulers of this Vijayanagar Empire, he constructed a palace for the guests. He was himself a writer and wrote in Telugu literature. This Vijayanagar Empire had a courtier, Pradhanna. Pradhanna is called as the Telugu Mahaprabhu. He is the father of the Telugu literature. There was one man, Jimut Bahan, in the court. Jimut Bahan had given a law which is called Dai Bhag law. Dai means what? Dai in Sanskrit means woman. So this Dai Bhag law is now applicable in the eastern part of India, Bengal, Assam, these areas. Why there were so many of sati cases in Bengal only? Even Ram Mohan's bhavi, she didn't commit sati because Ram Mohan prevented it. Ram Mohan made it that impossible to him. She was ready, and Ram Mohan's mother was, no, she must commit this sati. She must do this sati. But Ram Mohan was insistent, no, I'll not allow this. But a very important question, why after Bengal this sati system? Because of the Dai Bhag rules. Most of you follow, the Hindu follow the Mitakshar rule. Mitakshar rule was given by Bijaneshwar. He was also a court sent, and he that in Karnataka region, and so that is followed by mostly Hindus in India. But Dai Bhag, since gives more power and more inheritance right to wife, there is more sati. Na rahegi na bas bajega, bansuri bajegi, and so they forced women to commit sati. Write this. I'm just giving a brief outline. Political Islam came to Sindh in 712 by the attack of Muhammad bin Qasim he captured Sindh and Multan. He captured Sindh and Multan. This region was a Buddhist region. Mahmud of Ghazni started attacking the Punjab, Kandahar and Kashmir region from 11th century he attacked more than 20 times, looted the Somnath temple and the whole of Western India to enrich Ghazni. with Mahmood came Al-Biruni. Who wrote Kitabul Hind? Who wrote Kitabul Hind? Ultimately, the Delhi Sultanate was established and Qutbuddin Aibak became the first ruler. There were four dynasties . All of them were great builders. Qutub Minar was built by Qutubuddin. He started it. It was completed at the time of Balban. So in the cent was, and he is there, Qutubuddin Bakhtiar Kaki. Alauddin established a Siri town, Alai Darwaja, and mosques. Many of the temples were destroyed and converted to mosques. These sultans loved gardens and had established the Lodi Garden, the Tughlaq Garden, and probably one of the genius rulers, Muhammad bin Tughlaq, who was earlier Jauna Khan, and in whose service there was the Morocco traveler Ibn Battuta. Who wrote Muqaddimat. Ibn Battuta, Muqaddima.
That
was written in Morocco itself, not in India, that's why we are named. Ibn Battuta was a great pagal traveler. He was getting married, and so said, no, I am not made for marriage, and he fled from there and came to India. That's why there was a song, Ibn Battuta Pahan Ke Juta. And so, why this? This is a symbolic song. He could never rest. His, this boat, it was sunk in this Arabian Sea. Again, he came down somewhat, most of his travelers, partners, they were killed and they sunk. But then he came down and again he went to China after 3 years. Such a traveler, a pagal traveler, always on foot. So, this Ibn Battuta had written about India, and in this period, in the 14th century, Indian conditions were better, but there was much of poverty also. One woman could be bought in 1 taka, and man could be bought in 2 takas. This was a fact. Right. This. In this period, another scholar, Amir Khusro, was there, who invented sitar, who invented khayal, who invented tabla. Amir Khusro, two court members of Tughlaq, Muhammad bin Tughlaq, Harihar and Bukka, established the Vijayanagar Empire, probably 1336. Vijayanagar had 6 dynasties, starting from the Sangam to the Tulavas. That 6 dynasties. They were there from 1336 to 1565, that the great Rakshas war. And they were demolished almost by this Bahmani kings, a confederation of Bahmani kings. Vijayanagar had Krishnadev Rai, a poet, who in his court had Pedanna. He is called as Andhra Pitamah or Telugu Pitamah. Jimut Bahan was there, who gave the Daivhag rules. The Daivhag rules were given by Jimut Bahan. There was a lady, Mayanka, she wrote Madhura Vihar, or the victory over Madurai. They conquered Madurai also, they captured whole of South India, and probably whole of Sri Lanka was controlled by and captured by the Vijayanagar Empire. All Goa, everything was under their control. Krishnadev Rai contributed to Telugu literature and promoted Sanskrit language. They established a great temple town of Hampi. Vijayanagar was the political capital which had a guest house or a palatial guest house. So you remember that there was a question, contribution of Vijayanagar Empire, right? There can be a question of contribution of the Delhi Sultanate. The Delhi Sultanate, the four kingdoms, that can be. So since I am talking about this temple, I just give a brief. You still that question has not come, but write this. Discuss the temple types and significance of temples in India. Significance of temples in India. Now this, as far as this temples are concerned, there are basically two types of temples. One is called Naga temples. Naga temples. Naga temples have five parts: the Danda, the Dhwaja, the Shikhar, the Garbhagriha, the platform. These are the parts. And so this is Arey Baba, you see everywhere temples, and these all temples are Naga temples. But in Delhi, there are five temples where Dravid temples. So these Naga temples have also varieties. The other type of temples are the Dravid temples. But the Brihadarshya temple, the largest temple in India, is a Dravid temple. Brihadeshwar is the largest, no doubt about it. Rajraj I constructed it. So this in this place, Tanjore, that temple is there. So naturally, what we say that temples, though two types are Nagar and Dravid. A mixed type is called Besara, which have some kind of this Nagar style and some kind of a Dravid style. Nagar temples have never walls. They don't have boundaries. All Dravid temples have boundaries. All Dravid temples have long alleys from the Bihar to the whole minaret or the whole Shikhar. They have got a kind of long alley. Garbhagriha in the Nagar temple is inside the surface, very protected. In the Dravid temple, they are on the surface itself, very open, very not. Now, as far as the Besara temples are concerned, three places, Batapi or Badami, then this Aihole and this Tawakkal. These are the places where Rashtrakoot kings, they constructed them. One typical type of temple is by the Hoysala kings. Hoysalas were almost Karnataka king. Karnataka was very famous. Karnataka is famous for three things. It's a Jain center, the whole center of the Jains. The second thing, the great constructors, great builders. And the third thing, that they have started movements. This Kannada religion is started by a king, Amoghavarsha. Amoghavarsha was the king who started. He was a Rashtrakoot king, and he is supposed to be the father of Kannada literature. So there can be questions on temple structure. The second thing is that as far as the temples are concerned, many of the temples are excavated from large stones. Kailas temple by the Rashtrakoots, where in Ellora, it's almost on the sea, and it is excavated from the stone itself. Whole structure has been dug out from a mountain. So this is not a structured temple. Structured temple means when a separate building is constructed to be a temple. And as far as the temples are concerned, the regional differences are there. You go Odisha, Bhubaneswar is a temple town. Temple and temple. So in Konark, the Sun Temple now almost finished. It's all only the debris are there. But in Puri, you have got the temple, the Jagannath Temple. And so this is somewhat different from the ordinary Naga temples. The Naga temples have their very differences among them. Write this in brief, because temples in India are constructed in two patterns. One is from the large stone itself. For example, Kailashnath Temple or most of the cave temples in Ajanta and Ellora. Temples are basically two types. One is Nagar, North Indian temple construction started from the Gupta period, not before that. Guptas started temple construction. Devgarh is a Gupta temple. Nagar temples have five elements. Number one, dhwaja or the flag, danda, a kind of a stick, shikhara, then garbhagriha, where the main statue is placed, and then the platform. The second type, the Dravid temples, are always have boundaries they have alleys Alleys, that is a long way from the that what is that gate is called? Okay.
Elongated
path. No, the gate is in this. When I just say in time is there, then I'll tell you. Write this. There is in the Dravid temples the Viman is the main part, the Vimana is the main part which is the seeker of the Naga temple. The gates are called the Bihars. The gates are called the Bihars. The Gravgi is on the surface and they don't have platforms. Besara is a mixed type. Three places, Pottadakal, Aihol, and then Badami are the places where Besara temples are located, mixed types are located. In the temples, there are exceptions. So the Odisha temples are different than Hoysala, a Karnataka kingdom. They are star-like. Star-like temples. The Bengal temples have a rounded shikhar. Rounded shikhar. Now the question can be, I have already told you, temple types in India. Discuss the temple types in India. I have already told you. Then come down to this another feature. I say that the Mughals came 28 years after the Portuguese came to India. Portuguese came at 1498. Mughals came 1526. So 28 years gap later. Now what the Portuguese did in India? Culturally, Portuguese people thought that the only problem of India is that it is non-Christian. If we make it Christian, then the whole problem would be over. They become very sectarian, and probably one of the reasons and one of the lessons Britishers learnt from the Portuguese, the Britishers never encouraged conversion in India. They sent out Peter Grant, who was a monk, and he was a Christian monk. He said, no, you are not allowed to stay in India. Because they had realized, the Britishers had realized, Indians will not fight for their women, Indians will not fight for wealth, Indians will not fight for this power, they'll fight for religion. Religion is most dear to the Indians. They can never forget about their religion. So what the Portuguese did, Portuguese from Cochin to Goa and even beyond that constructed large number of churches. Those churches are in the Gothic style. Gothic style means they have a kind of a combination and not a unitary churches what we find now. The churches were just constructed by the Jesuits, constructed by the Catholics. They are also Catholics. Now, write this, two lines only. The Portuguese came to India in 1498, defeated the Arab traders who had monopolized the trade of Arabian Sea . The Portuguese felt, number one, the only problem of India is they all should be made Christians. And the second thing is that they were instrumental in the construction of Gothic churches. They started the printing press in India. They started the modern educational centers in India, Western educational centers in India. From them, Britishers learnt a lesson. In India, religious preaching is difficult. Difficult. It should not be just resorted to. The Mughals came 28 years after the Portuguese. Culturally, they had different types of emperors. Akbar was a liberal, Aurangzeb was a conservative. Now, just an anecdote, as far as personal life is concerned, Aurangzeb had the most simple life. He never slept on a kind of a he slept on the ground. He said, no, this is my religion's order that I must follow a very simple life. He had the least number of wives. How many? Only 3 wives. Akbar had how many? More than 300. I mean, he had also a harem. Akbar had a harem. But Aurangzeb never had a harem. But Aurangzeb said that I have been entrusted the task of making India into an Islamic state. Became a conservative despite this. And Akbar, what he did? He tried to just start a kind of a synthetic movement. Din-e-Ilahi was the religion he wanted to preach. But more than that, he tried to just interact with different people. And for that, he constructed a very special room. What was that room called? Ibadat Khana. Ibadat Khana was not for prayer. Ibadat Khana was a place where different religious people came and they interacted with them. He interacted with them. Akbar was a LLPP. LLPP means Likh Lodha Par Patthar. He was illiterate. He did not know any language. He was illiterate, but was in his own rights a kind of an enlightened man. And he tried to just have his own philosophies. He was not successful because he could neither please the Sufis nor please the sectarian Muslim mullahs. They were very conservative. And so as far as India is concerned, rather he was a very receptive audience among the Hindus here in India. Because Hindus have been following different kinds of religions, different, and they can accommodate anything. They go to the most of the Muslim shrines are visited by Hindus, and they say, oh no, I have to go to Khaja Baba and I have to do all these things. So that kind of tolerance is not there among the Muslims. And so despite this thing, write this, that the Mughals had two trends, liberal and conservative. Akbar represented the liberal trend. Aurangzeb represented the conservative trend. Culturally, Shah Jahan was the great because he built the Taj Mahal and he almost let down the foundation of Delhi as the capital. In this period, music advanced. And the Navratans of Akbar had Tansen also. Akbar respected the Sufi saints and probably he visited the shrine of Ajmer, previously Ajay Meru, founded by Ajay Raj. In his time, the Europeans had a significant presence and probably Akbar missed the bus. He was presented guns, mechanical watches, modern pen by the Portuguese and the Europeans. He kept them in his museum, did not start manufacturer of those instruments. This can be a question, missed the bus. So this was led to this man Tipu Sultan, who had his factory, a modern factory, and Tipu Sultan tried to do, but his place was very small. And then the original story, I have just left many things I wanted to tell you, but so remember, write one thing. The contribution of Mughals to art and culture. Then another thing, how Maharashtra Dharma led the foundation of Maratha subnationalism and the rule of Shivaji. Maratha subnationalism and the rule of Shivaji. Another question you can write. The Deccani Sultans, might have fought each other for long ...500 years, but they also contributed to culture, literature, and dance forms. You can write one thing. The British discuss the contribution of Britain in initiating modern theatre in India. So, have you heard anything about Maharashtra Dharma? Anything? No, but actually Maharashtra Dharma started, this was a movement, religious movement, from the 14th century. Must have heard the name of Sant Gyaneshwar. Sant Gyaneshwar wrote in Sanskrit, and he wrote an interpretation of Gita. But his followers, Tukaram, then Ramdas, the guru of Shivaji, they were writing in Marathi language, and they were worshipping the god Vithoba. Vithoba is a god which is supposed to be an incarnation of Vishnu in Maharashtra. So, and these people had a movement of almost 400 years, and Shivaji was inspired by them, and Shivaji thought of establishing a Hindu Padpatshahi just because of that imagination, just because of that kind of thing. Now, in India, I have already told you that one thing is very perpetual, rather two things. We have always a large group of sycophants. Oh, you are the Digvijay, you are the Chakravarti, you are the Dignity, all these things. And number two, that internal feuds, the Marathas could have captured political power after the decline of the Mughals. They gave the donations to the Mughals to survive. two-third of India was controlled by them in 1757, when after the war of Plassey, or the Battle of Plassey, the British captured the Bengal Suba. But what happened? They fought among themselves like anything. They didn't have any unity, and ultimately the Marathas fragmented into five areas: Baroda, Gwalior, Indore, then this Pune. And so these areas became different centers. Always a clash between the Peshwa and the Maratha ruler. Ultimately, the Peshwas become Bajirao Mastani, you must have seen. So he was a Peshwa, and then that kind of internal feuds. Probably the cultural achievements were also not great, because we could not unify ourselves. That conflict and that diversity. India today has much of diversity, but which is the uniting factor? Don't you think the whole of India is pagal and would be pagal after 15 days on what? Cricket. Cricket is the basis of nationalism right now. Even simple people say, why he sent that batsman, others should have been sent. The kind of identification people in India has with cricket. You see the matches. When India is evening, you ask anybody, are Coca-Cola pilao, ek kya do pilo. When India is getting defeated, so then aur kuch nahi karenge. So this is our cultural character, and this also shows Indian cinema. In South India, Hindi songs are less popular, but even then they are popular. In every part you go and you just listen to the Hindi songs. Everywhere Amitabh Bachchan, that Badal Khol, Salman Khan, I seeing him and just getting the hosts. All those things are there. Naturally, don't you think that this is a uniting factor? This is a uniting factor. The Sanskrit language and the legacy of Sanskrit language. That's a uniting factor. So these things have united one polity, one democracy, one kind of constitution, one economy. When the budget is being announced, every Indian looks towards that budget. What would happen and what is going to happen. So this is the whole, not the whole story, I couldn't just complete the whole outline, but I tried to just give an outline in Indian culture. There are two books you should consult, right? One is by NCERT. Indian Art and Architecture. Indian Art and Architecture. And another is a book by, probably the publication is, what is that? Indian Culture, I am just forgetting the name, by a lady. Kya hai, dekho to uska naam kya hai yaar, tumhare paas jo hai. Dekho, just let me see it. Yes, yes sir, this is the book probably. Spectrums. See, actually the book has been written by Mridula, I know, Kalpana Rajaram, that they are trying to just establish a coaching institute. She is the owner, but see this book, read this book, but probably you might find many differences from my lecture, because we just have a different perspective. But there are no other books, and this can give, the questions you get may not be covered by this book, because for example, the question that came, that the religious movements, bhakti movement didn't have an impact. This is not mentioned here. This you cannot cover by this or other kind of thing, and that difference between the Amravati, difference between, you know, collect this from different sources and whatever, and I'll also try to just give that to you. But as far as culture is concerned, they are very, very interesting thing, and I don't think that more than these questions, what I have tried to tell you, questions would be beyond that. The questions would be from that view. Okay, thank you very much.